Hello, it's Steve Fentress on behalf of the Strasenburgh Planetarium at the Rochester Museum and Science Center. This show was originally produced for the planetarium's 25th anniversary, and it used 35mm slides and clips from oral histories that were recorded in the early 1990s. Then it was transferred to video for the planetarium's 40th anniversary. Of course, there's a whole new story for the planetarium's 50th anniversary, but that's another show. Records of the early days are fragmentary. The notes from the Planetarium Planning Committee have never been found. You'll hear reference to a Hoffmeister report, which Steve Thomas told me he actually wrote and Hoffmeister put his name on. In any case, that has never turned up. But there's still plenty to see and hear in this show that will bring you right up to 1968.
Museum Service, Bulletin of the Rochester Museum of Arts and Sciences, Arthur C. Parker, Director, December 1935. One by one, the great cities of the world are building their planetariums. The beauty and utility of the planetarium in Jena awakened the civilized world to its desirability. Soon, Moscow had as fine a plant as Germany. Then came the building of one in Chicago, followed fast by Philadelphia, and now New York with its Hayden Planetarium, and Los Angeles with its Griffith Observatory vie with one another across a continent. Rochester needs one of these indices of cosmos as a part of its museum system, and the new museum building that is to come must plan for Rochester's planetarium. How shall Rochester get its planetarium? Who knows? Certainly there are men and women in Rochester, like others in our American cities, who are generous and farsighted. One thing is certain, Rochester will have a planetarium someday.
George Hawks, attorney for Mr. and Mrs. Edwin Strasenburgh. Mrs. Strasenburgh expressed to me the idea that she and Edwin very much would like to do something for Rochester. And they were looking for something to give to the city. I had been president of the Rochester Museum and Science Center. We had developed a plan for a planetarium. Steve Thomas was the director of the museum at the time.
Steve Thomas and I was director of what was the Rochester Museum of Arts and Sciences.
We could not afford architects to employ one to make a model or anything like that. Well, what I did was, I had a cousin, Olindo Grassi, who was professor of architecture at the Pratt Institute. He said, I have a graduate student who's getting his master's at the Long Island University in architecture, and this could be his thesis. And then the beautiful picture of the model done by Wenrick.
I mentioned to the Strasenburghs that there was a model of a planetarium that had been developed by Dr. Edward Hoffmeister of the university. I said that if they were interested in something of that nature, that Mr. Thomas would be delighted to go out and see them. They said they would, said they very much would like to talk to Mr. Thomas.
My name is Carl Kelber, and I was the architect of the building. My role was come up with the idea of the building. I had been in London. I went out to London Zoo. I usually, whenever I'm in a city like that and there's a zoo around, I like to go out and check the zoo out because of interest in animals and that sort of thing. And at the London Zoo at that time, there was a wonderful elephant house. This elephant building rather knocked me out. It was a poured concrete building, and the forms were slotted, and much of the trim, the roof trim type stuff, was standing seam copper. One of the earlier expressions in concrete, in ridged concrete like that, that I'd seen. My structural partner at the time, Herbert Kopf, was going to London, and I asked him to measure the size of the flutes. And he did that and brought those measurements back, and those measurements were incorporated into this building.
Sky and Telescope magazine, April 1968, a major planetarium in Rochester. To create a realistic outdoor environment, our chamber's horizon is being set considerably lower than in conventional planetariums. Viewers will have the feeling of looking across at the opposite horizon rather than looking up out of a great well. For this reason, the entrance to the theater must be through a tunnel and ramp under the peripheral skyline.
It was a happy experience, I think, for everybody. I think everybody took pride in it. The workmen were proud of it, because nothing like this had ever been done in Rochester before.
For many months while driving up and down the avenue, East Avenue that is, I've watched the progress of the Strasenburgh Planetarium, which has been under construction for quite some time now. I recall almost as if it were yesterday when the Bausch home was raised, and shortly after, it seemed, the ground was broken, and then began a most ambitious project, the building of a magnificent planetarium at a cost to the donors of $2.5 million. Well, it's nearly complete now, should be done by next month, which is why we asked the director, Ian McLennan, to let you and me go through in advance of opening. Now, where we now stand will one day be what, Ian?
This is the... Can we stand here?
Mm-hmm.
This is the main public assembly area. There's a large assembly area where roughly 250 people can be held. And here they will wait before going up into the theater itself, which is just at the other side of this very large ramp you see here. There is a motion picture screen that drops out there to give you a pre-show introduction so that you know what to expect when you get into the theater itself.
Don't you feel like a pioneer being the first director of the planetarium here in Rochester?
Well, it is quite a challenge, but and it's particularly an interesting challenge because we've had an opportunity to look at planetariums in every corner of the world leading up to the design of this. We've had the opportunity of eliminating common mistakes and at the same time taking advantage of experiments elsewhere and incorporating our own ideas into it, including computerizing the operations. The first time that a planetarium anywhere has been computerized, yes.
Oh, I think computing has gone far enough. I think we can stop any time.
Well, as long as it doesn't take over my job, that's all right.
Digital Equipment Corporation, Maynard, Massachusetts, to Rochester Museum Association. Gentlemen, thank you for your inquiry. We are pleased to quote as follows. One standard PDP-8 computer, rack-mountable version, with 4K core memory and ASR33 teleprinter. $18,000 minus educational discount.
Contract of sale between the Rochester Museum Association and the firm of Carl Zeiss, Oberkochen, Württemberg, West Germany. The subject of the contract is a planetarium projection instrument designed for the projection of stars and other celestial bodies on a hemispherical projection dome of 20 meters diameter. For the sum of $238,000, the vendor shall deliver to the premises of the buyer in good condition the following. One planetarium projector, model 6, with its projectors and supplementary devices. 1.1 centerpiece with polar altitude drive, continuous speed variation range 1 to 12 minutes per revolution. 1.2 diurnal drive, continuous speed variation range 1 to 72. Duration of a day 30 seconds to 36 minutes. 1.3 annual drive, continuous speed variation range 1 to 72. Duration of a year 10 seconds to 12 minutes. 1.4 precession drive, continuous speed variation range 1 to 12 minutes per revolution. 1.5 slip rings with electric motion.
Mr. Ms. Strasenburgh and all 12 grandchildren, I'm standing here tonight. Friends, what can one say after we have had the chance to sit in the cockpit of the good spaceship Earth and take the kind of trip so carefully reproduced in terms of reality as we have tonight, in the tremendous accomplishment of this staff, of these most professional people in using optics to the nth degree in a city that is not unknown for its excellence in that field. While we have inevitably realized from this experience that man as a unit of mass or energy in the vastness of this universe is a triviality, we have at the same time recognized that the human intellect, the power of the human intelligence, is without a doubt the greatest force that has brought about this understanding. And certainly, if you incorporate the spiritual experience of mankind in the product of his intellect, the most powerful force in this vast universe, at least as we know it, or will know it, for a long time to come.